My background in music came about actually because of my interest in science. When I was a kid, I was a big student of science. And when I went to college, they had a radio station, a college radio station. And I went down as an engineer and ended up a disc jockey. And that was really formative in my life. At the time, the music and the politics were just so alive. We had two stations, an AM station and an FM station. And over the course of my time there, the FM station increasingly became rock. But the FM had all kinds of programming, including classical. And I had one experience back in the day where I was the supervisor of the radio stations for the night, and both disc jockeys on the AM and the FM called in sick at the same time. So I ended up running down the hall between the two studios, doing a top 40 show on the AM station for the campus, and then for the community, doing a classical music show called Classics by Request. Now, I knew nothing about classical music. Fortunately, it was a request show, so I didn't have to worry about that. I just had to read the liner notes. I was no Rich Caparella, but then, you know, who is? But rock and roll was what got me going. Radio became my first career, and eventually that brought me to Los Angeles. And it was in the height of my hippie days, and I became the general manager of K-Rock here when it was really kind of an experimental free-form FM radio station. That I then got into advertising, which is where they continued to pay me for being creative, which I kind of liked. And at one point, one of my clients was a laser show called Laserium that used to happen up at Griffith Observatory and all over the country. And I put together the music track for their first ever classical music show. And I really remember doing that very distinctly, because up until then, it had all been a matter of splicing rock and roll on the beat. When I had to put together a soundtrack of classical music, and there was no drum beat to refer to, it became much more of a job of conducting. And I actually stood there in the studio conducting the music, trying to see if I could get it so it all flowed together. And the radio ad that I made for that show, the show was called Crystal Odyssey, ended up winning a major advertising award. So I was very proud of the work I had done on that. It was my first, you know, real foray into working that intimately with classical music. I ended up here in Santa Monica because of my work at K-Rock, got increasingly involved in the community, and in the late 90s ran for and won a seat on the city council. So since that time, as a city council member, I spent over a decade as the council liaison to the Arts Commission and worked with a lot of the artists here in town, including musicians. I'm very proud of that involvement and helped toward the end of that period to work on a report we call Creative Capital, which is the one that I cited earlier, that 43% of the people in Santa Monica make part of their living in the arts. I am someone who deeply believes that the arts are more than just an economic force. You know, we live in a very commercial society where people are being motivated all the time, but the arts inspire us, and we need that. And I think anybody whose life is not touched by the arts is living an incomplete life.
Yes, that's beautifully stated. Thank you. Thank you, Kevin. And we also have an East Coast connection, of course. That fact that you grew up right outside of New York City, I grew up on Long Island, and we both made our way, well, for 5 years, I was in California and now in Bloomington, Indiana. But it's fantastic to see that the arts play such a major role in Santa Monica, the West Side in general. So I agree completely. How about you, Nathan?
Well, I've got council members' discussion about K-Rock and everything. I've got a bunch of questions I'd love to ask him, but we'll get to that maybe later. But I do have to jump in and say, I grew up in the New York area in Nassau County. So it sounds like we all have New York as a
Manhasset,
frame of
Manhasset, New York right here.
East Meadow and then Great Neck, as my father moved up. Kevin, where were you? Where did you grow up in the New York area?
Mount Vernon, Westchester County.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. Well, so you're literally 10 minutes away from me, Nathan.
Right. And in fact, one of my earliest musical memories is playing in a little family trio. I played the flute, my mother played the viola, and my brother played the piano for church services at the Unitarian Church in Manhasset. Oh, yeah. So every Sunday we went to Manhasset to play music for the congregation. I was nine. So I studied the flute. We had a musical family. I, as you know, Roger, from my little bio, I'm not quite sure where to begin, except we had a very musical family. My brother was ambitious to be a concert pianist. My mother was a professional musician. She played from age 3 to age 83.
Wow.
Which of course is one of the great things about music, is that, you know, it's a life. It's a life. It's not a thing you do once in a while. And I started out, and my father was an editor and writer for Time magazine, and the arts were a specialty. So he took us to many, many things. We were at Leonard Bernstein, the New York Philharmonic. We went to the opera. He would take us to European festivals and stuff like that. I mean, we led a charmed life when it came to the arts. In my family, I started with the flute. And then I also started early doing some electronic music composition. We had a tape recorder, and somehow I became very fascinated with tape music. One thing is that my mother, who grew up in Fort Worth, Texas during the Depression, in a very, very conservative situation, became absolutely devoted and obsessed with 20th century music, which is just a fascinating thing.
Mm-hmm.
She locked on to 20th century music, and that was her great interest. So we had it in our house. Stravinsky, Debussy, Berg, Berio, Stockhausen, all of that was what I grew up with, in addition to rock and roll, of course, which is in the house. So I started experimenting with tape music at age about 11. And I went to Stanford to study music in order to take advantage of the computer music system that they had there, which was one of only two in the world. I arrived as an undergraduate and found out from the music department that undergraduates weren't even allowed in the building. So I switched gears and got a degree in something else that I was also equally interested in, which is the theater. So I ended up studying both music and theater. I went to the Guildhall School of Music and Drama in London for study both. And then I ended up getting a master's in music from UCSD, mm-hmm. which is a very interesting place because it was entirely devoted to 20th century music. In fact, you weren't really allowed to play anything pre-1900 on your concert programs without special permission.
I had no idea. That's fascinating.
And it was all composers. We used to joke that the janitors were composers. Everybody was, which created this kind of hothouse atmosphere. Fabulous teachers. John Cage came to visit. I worked with him and conducted one of his pieces under his tutelage for a couple of weeks. I studied with Roger Reynolds, who's a very well-known West Coast composer, Robert Erickson, who's kind of a legend, and Pauline Oliveros, who's a fabulous person who just passed last year. A music fan in the science departments once asked Roger, "Why do you only play 20th century music? I want to hear 19th century music and 18th century music." And Roger famously replied, "We'll teach 18th century music when you teach 18th century science."
I never would have imagined when I first moved to the West Coast that San Diego was such a popular spot for contemporary music, but it sounds...
Well, you can really attribute that to Robert Erickson, my composition teacher, who was also the teacher of Pauline Oliveros and Terry Riley and some other well-known people, when he helped start the San Francisco Tape Center in the 60s. This is all California, this is all West Coast classical music lore that I've got in my head. But when UCSD started in the late 60s, the arts departments wanted to be cutting edge, and they looked around for the most innovative people they could find to launch the departments. They picked Robert Erickson from the Bay Area, and they got, I can't think of his name right now, a performance art, very early performance art person to start the visual arts department, which were both together in the Mandeville Center in a single building, and they did a lot of things together, actually. Alan Capro was his name.
Okay.
And so when Robert Erickson started the department, he said it's going to be all 20th century music, and he handpicked a group of not just avant-garde, but in some cases radical composers, and they said if you want to do something else, go somewhere else. This is what we're doing, and right. They branded it, and it was a brilliant idea.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, let's talk about a little bit about your favorite musical pieces, genres. That's something that is interesting to me because as a conductor, a lot of times people think I only conduct classical music, but I actually love electronic music, of classic rock, and especially jazz, Louis Armstrong, Miles Davis. I was a trumpet player. So it really is a mix of genres that really speak to me as a conductor. Kevin, what music really speaks to you? What do you enjoy?
Well, I grew up, in the 60s, in the era of the tremendous transformation of pop music from kind of a disposable wallpaper into being, say, an art form. Yeah. And the very first year that I was a disc jockey on that radio station at Yale, a record came out that to me kind of embodies all the changes that were happening. And that is Good Vibrations.
Yes.
Which has been described as a pocket symphony, actually. I think it has 6 different sections in 3.5 minutes. I mean, that's more changes than the average symphonic piece goes through in an hour. And it was put together in a very innovative way. It was a studio record. It would be almost impossible to play it live. I know the Beach Boys do, but they don't really do what was done in that studio where Brian Wilson had all these different little musical vignettes and put them together to form this 3.5 minute mini symphony. Mm-hmm. And what struck me about it, and looking back, I have a different view, but what struck me at the time was the integration of instrumentation that had not been typically rock and roll. I mean, one of the main rhythm instruments in that very driving song is a cello. Mm-hmm. And there's a part toward the end, I've seen video of him, telling the cello player harder, 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 really pushing the bounds of what had been done with that instrument. Another instrument on there very notably is an electronic one called the theremin. You talked about electronic music. It actually wasn't a true theremin where you move your hand. It was an electro theremin where you turn a knob, but it was the first one really to be in a pop music hit. Also, that began that whole era of the changes that happened. If you think about rock and roll in 1965 and rock and roll in 1967, they're very different. And 66 was that year where that transition was happening. The Beatles were doing it, the Beach Boys were doing it, the Rolling Stones were beginning to do it. And all of a sudden, songs weren't just about unrequited love. I mean, I think until then, probably the biggest chorus in rock and roll was baby, baby, baby. And for the first time, songs began to be about other things, and the openness to different instrumentation, different chord structures, different ways of presenting an idea that was still conceptually rock and roll, but also integrated all the hundreds of years of musical experience we've had. To me, that was a seminal moment. Beach Boys, 1966, Good Vibrations.
Absolutely. And
I still get good vibrations from that song.
Well, you sent me a great clip. I'd love to play just a minute or so of that studio recording. Yeah. It's the first time I ever saw this recording. It's a fantastic video. And I have to say, the first concert I ever saw, I was in sixth grade, was the Beach Boys in New York at Jones Beach Amphitheater. So this, and we'll watch a little bit of Good Vibrations. Here we go. She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up. Thank you. Fantastic stuff. Is that part of a larger documentary? Do you know?
I think it is. And it's great there to see Brian Wilson in his element at his prime.
Yes.
Unfortunately, it didn't show much of the uncommon instrumentation. The drummer there was Hal Blaine. They used the Wrecking Crew, the famous LA studio group, for much of the backing of that. I think Carol Kane played bass, but you also saw string bass in there. I mean, Brian was very affected by the Phil Spector wall of sound, and the idea of double and triple instrumentation was a part of how that got to be such a full sounding record.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, symphonic. It's symphonic in a way, the quality, the sound. Really great stuff.
Yeah. That was still recorded in four tracks, probably, right, Kevin?
I don't really know. 1966.
That's right. It could be. It could have been bouncing down to stereo all the way along, which is also mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Much of what you saw in that clip was actually the layering on of the vocals, which was the last thing that happened. Apparently, Brian put the music track together and played it over the phone for Carlos and one of his brothers. And you know, then they all came in and matched their vocals to the already recorded music track.
But I was just reading, because I'm part of a group, an online group called 60s and 70s San Francisco Rock. And one of the things that we're discussing right now is how everyone's lost their hearing, unfortunately. I don't know whether, but interesting to note that The Who now performs watching each other's lips and feeling the bass through their guts, because they can't really hear each other very well anymore. One of the loudest bands in history, The Who.
Yeah.
The thing that I produced when I owned a radio recording studio here in Santa Monica on Main Street for a number of years, and I worked with a woman named Rachel Donahue, and we did a documentary for KFOG in San Francisco on the history of San Francisco rock and roll. So That was a wonderful era. I mean, the appreciation for musicianship that happened at the same time as the relaxation of what had been the so-called rules of rock and roll. You know, that if you wanted to get a song on the radio, everything had to be under 3 minutes. Well, that ended with FM. Thank goodness. Well,
of course, and FM radio, I mean, this is what, radio was, of course, at the center of everything. I mean, I remember as a kid having a transistor radio under my pillow at night, which I listened to well after the lights were out. And K-Rock, of course, was incredibly important. But I just think that's a really interesting point, if you'll permit me to jump in for a second, because I'm actually writing about this at the moment. I had a great experience in 1974 where I met the members of the band Yes, and I was able to attend rehearsals and recording sessions with the band. And that was when, I mean, I had all been a classical music kid who had appreciated rock and roll, you know, was obsessed with rock and roll. But it wasn't until I sat in the studio with musicians of that caliber that it finally dawned on me that rock musicians were every bit as talented and in some cases technically brilliant as classical musicians. They were playing a very, very different language, completely different. But had Mozart or Bach or Beethoven been alive, they would have been incredibly impressed with the music that came out between 1966 and 1974 or so. Absolutely astounding time in world history music. And I just have to throw that out.
Well, I'll have to read that article that you're working on. So please share it with us when you finish.
It's one of my favorite bands. And so with me, another is Frank Zappa, who, you know, talk about the composer in the era of rock and roll. When I was at K-Rock, Frank had an album he wanted to put out, and he wanted to put out a four-disc album, and the record company balked at that. Frank came down to the studio, and I was in the studio with him when he did this, and played the lacquer test pressings of his album so people could hear it and record it off K-Rock. And sitting in that room with Frank and watching him and listening to what he had to say, such an impressive intellect. And such a real appreciation for music. He was doing things in those recordings, and this would be in the late 70s at that point, that I think are still ahead of their time.
Yeah,
and I listened to those recordings, and I just shake my head in awe at some of the stuff that was being done.
Yeah, and he had a great collaboration with L.A. Phil and Zubin Mehta, And Zubin was one of the first conductors to really bring in rock and roll with the symphony orchestra. You think about also later years with Metallica and the San Francisco Symphony. And actually, I think that goes back all the way to the Beatles.
Eleanor Rigby, completely turned right. rock and roll upside down with a string quartet. Listening back to it, the string quartet's the only accompaniment in this song. There's nothing else.
But Nathan, let's go to your piece, because I know you shared with me a brilliant piece by Igor Stravinsky.
Well, of course, as I mentioned, I grew up in a family that was very oriented towards 20th century music. So I was hearing Stravinsky from an early age. So I was thrilled when in my master's program at UC San Diego to be asked to play one of the four piano parts in Stravinsky's Les Noces, which is a rarely performed piece, partly because it's kind of a strange ensemble, four pianos and a cimbalom, which is a Hungarian hammered dulcimer instrument, and a bunch of unusual percussion. There's a tradition that the four pianos in Les Noces are taken by four composers. So there was a sense at this very composer-oriented program at UC San Diego that this is a piece that we should do with four student composers. So I was asked to play piano four, which is kind of the bass part. It was conducted by a terrific French fellow, a percussionist who knew what he was doing. But we had a mezzo-soprano by the name of Diamanda Galas, who was my classmate. Mm-hmm. Diamanda has gone on to international fame since then as a soloist, doing extraordinary original work. She has an instrument that is just unlike anyone else's. She's a kind of a monster in the solo vocal area. So she made it very, very exciting too. So it was a terrific performance. I fell in love with the piece, and we did this really compelling version of it. Unfortunately, there's only a couple of versions of it online. So I don't know which one you want to play, Roger, but sure. Of the two that I found, one is a rendition with some video that looks like it's being done by a music school in Switzerland, which is well done. But the other one is done by a group. I don't know if you know this group, Roger. They're pretty well known in Russia for doing ethnic research and creating ethnic Russian dances and music on stage in a really almost kind of shockingly ancient way. It's really kind of been a kind of slap in the face to the other folk dance and music traditions in Russia, and completely kind of revolutionized it. And they decided to choose this Stravinsky piece, which has certain roots in that ethnic Russian and do it with some of that quality. And so it sounds a little bit at first like what we used to call the Bulgarian women's choir sound, which is a very intense, sometimes very dissonant, a sharp vocal sound. And
skip ahead to the 8-minute mark, because I think that's the other spot you wanted to play. Here's Aida.
Okay.
great stuff. I can't imagine performing that work, Nathan, how you must have felt and the challenges technically and musically required. I mean,
yes, and hardly any two bars of the same time signature together. So you're counting, of course. That's what you do in a lot of contemporary music. You spend a lot of time counting. And the conductor sometimes looks a little nervous about counting as well. but considering the entire ensemble and the conductor never did anything but 20th century music, you know, we were pretty well prepared for it. It was a great performance.
Bravo. Yeah, it really, I can't wait to dive into that piece more. I've conducted the ballets, but not that specific ballet. I've done the, you know, Rite of Spring, the Firebird Suite, Petrushka, but none of, not Les Noces.
And do you integrate 20th century music into your programs in Santa Monica, I think, don't you?
Oh, absolutely. We've done a lot of premieres in Santa Monica. We've invited the composer to come to the performance and speak a little bit about the piece. We've done really all sorts of music, mixing Beethoven with modern music, for example. Right. So when I program, I try to really include the War Horses with a contemporary work, you know, something that tells a story. I wanted to ask you about audiences in Santa Monica. You know, I talk to a lot of friends and they tell me they see classical music as being boring, as being elitist, as being a museum. So my question though is, you know, do you see classical music as being relevant today? And how do we get younger, or not even just younger audiences, but people who may not be interested in classical music into the concert hall, specifically Santa Monica? But it's a problem all over the country.
Well, I find classical music to be uncommonly immersive. And by that, I mean, it's a somewhat different experience from going to a rock concert where you're going to hang out with your friends and dance or whatever. To me, when I go to a classical concert, I escape the moment and I relive emotionally what the composer and conductor and musicians have put in to this sonic wall that I'm facing. Right. So to me, that experience is unique and to be sought after. And that's what brings me to a concert, no matter whether the piece of music was composed 250 years ago, happy birthday, Ludwig, or, you know, recently. Teamwork and community at work that somehow transforms just the sound into something more.
You know, that's a great point in terms of immersion, since that immersive is such a buzzword these days in the performing arts. Of course, performing arts are nowhere at the moment. We've got to climb back out of this hole when people start getting vaccinated. But with the optimism that will happen, you know, I took my family, my parents and my kids, who are not used to going to classical concerts, to sit in the side, the upper seats of the side of the orchestra in Disney Hall for Beethoven's Ninth. And to talk about immersion, I mean, when the choral sections, the big choral sections at the end, I mean, you feel like you're absolutely, you know, drowning or whatever, you know, you're completely surrounded utterly with this incredible sound. So another thought about bringing in younger audiences and other audiences is to try to maybe bring more people up on stage, make it literally more immersive, bring you know, singers and players out into the hall is one thought. I also noticed that sometimes you know, people really respond when their kids are in something. So there was a Jacaranda, another local arts organization, for a short time did a program where students were put next to professional musicians on the stage for performance. That, of course, brought in all these parents, which we know in Santa Monica is huge. The parents are very supportive of their kids doing music. So maybe more integration of the kids. And one last thought, some pieces require kids. I mentioned another piece that to Roger earlier that I thought I might pick, Benjamin Britten's Noah's Flood, which involves seven different children's choirs, K through 12. Kids are involved in it, as well as a group of young, early 20s or late teen singers who sing the parts of Noah's kids. So you get, it's like a massive community effort to do Benjamin Britten Noah's Flood. So those kinds of things help hook in families, I think.
It's Wonderful.
Another thought, which is video visuals. I also noted that Esapekka started to do more collaborations with big screen stuff that was going on. I don't know if Dudamel's also done the same, but a program, not just a camera on the conductor like the Hollywood Bowl, but an actual visual program created by video artists or directors or something like that can also really lend something exciting for younger audiences who are used to the visual.
Of course, Roger, an audience has to have a place to gather to assemble with an appropriate venue for that kind of performance to be heard as it's meant to be heard. I've been on the city council 22 years. I'm very committed to getting our civic auditorium open again. I think that is a hugely important venue for the city of Santa Monica. Something I'm very proud of that I began before I got onto the city council. I was on a committee called Restore Barnum Hall. And we took that 1938 hall, which at that point was a wreck with hot and cold running rats, and turned it back into a venue we could be proud of. And an unexpected gift to me was, as mayor, I've gotten to introduce musical events on the stage of Barnum Hall, knowing that somewhere out there in the audience, there's a seat with my name on it. I never have found that seat, though.
Thank you for your efforts, Kevin. No, that means so much to us. And Moss Theater is where we perform. The Moss Theater is great because there's this you're so close to the audience that it feels like you could touch them, and it creates a wonderful, as you said, immersive listening experience. And we love performing there. We do most of our concerts there, and we've rehearsed at Barnum. Rehearsed at St. Monica's Church, the Catholic Church. And it's tricky, I find, because there are a lot of groups playing in these different venues. And it seems like, there are only so many places where we can rehearse or perform. I'd love to hear your thoughts on possible venues or other creative solutions we can come up with as an organization.
Even before the pandemic, the economics were challenging.
Sure. And
continue to be. I don't think we're going to get the Civic Auditorium back online until we find a partner. It's going to have to be a public-private partnership. Barnum, we're very fortunate. That is on the campus of the school district at Samo High. So that's being taken care of by them. The Moss Theater you're talking about, that's the Herb Alpert venue. I've actually introduced your concerts in that hall, or someone else's concert, maybe, but I've been in
that. Allen's, yeah.
It's hard to imagine how we would be building many more of those venues. What we really have to focus on, I think, is keeping what we have. And again, the fact that the Civic Auditorium has now sat vacant for, I believe it's 7 years, breaks my heart. I didn't want to close it. I was a vote against that closure. But again, the economics were pretty compelling. It was costing us a lot of money to keep it open, and the building needed seismic retrofits before we could allow sizable audiences in there again. I just want to assure everybody I have not forgotten the Civic Auditorium.
It's been fantastic to hear, Council Member. And of course, without Councilman McKeown's efforts to the arts, we would have a lot less in Santa Monica. He's been an absolute champion for the dozen years that I've been working for the city. And boy, I tell you, we appreciate it, Council Member, let me tell you. Now, when it comes to, I've also been involved in real estate for the arts for much of my career, since I started a master plan for an art center at Angels Gate Park in San Pedro for the city of LA, and then worked on Bergamot and other planning things in Santa Monica. We do have a few excellent music venues. We don't have, we have almost no theater venues anymore, just a couple. So that's a real issue. But when it comes to music, there's also the Broad Stage. Moss, as you mentioned, Barnum is fantastic. And of course, eventually we hope that the Greek Theater outside there may come online again as potential. And boy, we sure do hope that something will happen with the Civic. Because it will need not only the retrofit, but a lot of modernization and the changing of the space in there and stuff like that. So it's going to be a big deal. So really the only thing standing between Santa Monica and more use of its musical venues is money right now. And it would be great if we could find some philanthropists, or because real estate philanthropy is now a thing and a really important thing for the arts, since gentrification became overwhelming in our cities. So there may be a way of leveraging philanthropic dollars for this, because even with Moss, as you know, and Barnum, and certainly with Broad, it's not cheap to get into those spaces. And our arts organizations, we've got to find a way to make it affordable for arts organizations so that we can pack those places, yeah, kind of concerts that people in Santa Monica want to go see.
Yeah, that's a good point. And it does come down to the economics, the money, and bringing in donors and bringing in patrons. Something I started with Orchestra Santa Monica is a happy hour, a symphony happy hour, where we go to Upper West on Pico, and I talk about the music and what to expect, and we invite the guest soloist, and this takes place a few days before the concert. We've been really successful pre-pandemic in making that happen, and it's a great way to meet people who may support the symphony, for instance, and future audience members and donors. That's been really successful, the symphonic happy hours that we're doing. And I look forward to doing that again when this pandemic has passed. I just want to leave you with this question. You know, attending live concerts and performing music has become such a routine activity for us for so many years. You know, then all of a sudden this world crisis happens and we're no longer to see concerts or attend concerts in front of a live audience. How has your attitude towards music changed? And what do you miss most?
I have a hunger for live performance, and I think a lot of people will. And when the vaccine has been distributed and we feel it's safe again, and we have to be cautious, and we reopen those venues, I think that there'll be a lot of people who really want to get out and hear some live music. In the meantime, you know, what do? I have learned to do more focused listening. You know, many of us listen to music in the background when we're doing other things. I have now made it a practice to actually pay attention to what I'm listening to, which sometimes increases the enjoyment manyfold. I'm in the process right now here at home of digitizing my entire vinyl LP collection. I am up to P right now. As you can imagine, after many years in radio, I have a lot of records. In fact, if you look on the wall behind me, you can see a gold record up there, which actually isn't a gold record. That was an award given to me by the city staff after the first time I was mayor in recognition of my history in radio. But I do have a lot of records from exactly that period you talked about, Roger, 66 to 74. And what I'm doing is one by one, cleaning them, putting them on a turntable, recording them into a computer, and then putting them back on the shelf because, you know, how often do you take out a vinyl record? But I have the access to it now on my computer. I'll be listening. But as I'm doing it, I'm hearing all this music and paying attention to it again. And I'm looking forward to getting up to Y, because the Yes albums are among my favorites.
That's so neat. That's so fantastic. Good luck with that. I know it does take time. How about you, Nathan?
Well, I'm thrilled to hear that the council member and I have something in common in Yes. So maybe there will be another opportunity to talk a little bit more about that. I certainly, you know, we also have K-Rock in common, because that was on constantly in the 1980s for me. And among other, for example, The Smiths was a band that I became obsessed with thanks to How Soon Is Now on heavy rotation on K-Rock. I don't know if those were your days, Kevin, or not, but anyway. In the theater, I know that people in LA have been saying a lot, oh my gosh, it's never coming back. It'll never be the same. It's all going to be gone. And I know that performing arts are being hit almost harder than any other industry. It's just devastating. I mean, nobody can do anything. It was never a field with huge profit margins to start with. Even our friends in New York who work on Broadway were saying Broadway's never coming back. It's never going to be the same. Well, you know, I guess it's natural to think that way, but we can see now that it will. Of course, it will. The Spanish flu was followed by the Roaring Twenties, as I like to point out, and pent up demand, to use a marketing term for live performance. People have to and want to and have a almost an animal need to get together in a big space and share music and dancing and everything. Mm-hmm. We are going to do it, and it may be that young people come back first, actually. because they're a little less risk adverse, and it may be a good for the performing arts industries that young people come back first, because that's been such a difficult thing over the years, is to try to get a younger audiences. I don't know how I've fully answered your question. I mean, Kevin, I've spent a lot of time listening to recorded music. I'm writing a play, actually. It's not an essay that takes place in 1972 in San Francisco. So I've been up to my eyeballs in Moby Grape and Quicksilver Messenger Service and It's a Beautiful Day and stuff like that. Power of Power and all kinds of I'm having a great time with that, but I tell you, we can't live with this like this. It has to come back, and it will come back. And Roger, a lot of that it has to do with you and what your organization is able to do, and we're cheering for you.
Thank you. It's going to be a very emotional moment when we're all back on stage again. I keep saying that to the musicians. We keep in touch monthly through Zoom meetings with the staff, the musicians, and we're looking at doing chamber music, outdoor chamber music concerts, hopefully soon. Not in a venue, but outdoors with maybe 5 musicians. I figure start small and then go big, go back to the full orchestra eventually. And we're really trying to stay connected through activities like this, and chatting with you. You gave me so many great ideas.
The city's role is we will try to make possible things that might not happen without some seed money. We can't, as a city, fund everything. But what we can do is give the basic money that will then be leveraged to find patrons and others who could also contribute. And I think even in the midst of the economic collapse we're suffering because of the pandemic, that's one of the things that our city we'll look at as a priority.
That's wonderful to hear. Thank you. And I have some wonderful photos that you sent me.
I can see it.
There it is. There's the...
Well, Kevin, did you overlap with the Rodney Bingenheim days and all that?
Yes, I did. In the very beginning of punk rock in the late 70s.
Wow.
And were you there in the 80s?
I was there from 76 through 78. No, I wasn't there when it turned rock of the 80s. That was a much tighter, more typically radio format than we had. We were the last station, really, where somebody could walk in with a box of their own records and play them on the air.
Awesome.
That's so neat, I think. And Nathan, there's a great photo of you. I believe you're conducting. Let me just find.
And in this case, Professor Michael Hackett and I created, here we go, several occasions, Professor Michael Hackett in the theater department there and I created musicals for the students to perform. In this case, it was one based on The Scarlet Letter.
I see.
So I'm conducting the a music rehearsal with the students.
That's awesome. I love it. And I think at that point, did you have much conducting training, or was this something new for you when you were doing that?
I agreed. I actually came up with the idea when I was 19 years old and a sophomore in college of conducting Noah's Flood, this piece, which involves 175 members of the community at Stanford Church. I had never conducted anything before in my life. So by the time we opened, I had learned a little bit about conducting. So that I learned on the job, Roger, in a scary situation with 175 people in front of me.
Props to you, sir. This photo of you, Kevin, here looks great. What, this was from your time at the radio?
No, this is actually at the end of my first time being mayor. So
I see. Okay.
The end of 2015. That gold record actually says Mayor Kevin McKeown on the label. And the thing down below says 93,000 served. It was basically a take on my radio history, thanking me for my year as mayor. So that's actually on the dais at City Hall.
And you had that on your wall, right? You said, I think.
That's the one that's on the wall behind me here right now today.
Oh, neat. That's what an honor. Yeah.
Well, may I ask, Kevin, holding an Irish passport as you do, I presume you sing?
No, you know, one of the great regrets I have is I have no musical talent whatsoever. I think as a kid, I once learned how to play This Land Is Your Land on a banjo, and that was about it. and so then when I got into radio and began to relate to music in the different way, it was really interesting to me. I mean, I was really good at segues and putting music together in coherent ways, but I couldn't play a note, nor can I sing.
So no Irish tenor. Oh, okay.
There's a great photo of you in Ireland at a pub. Let me just pull this up real quickly.
One of the great pleasures we've had the pandemic has been traveling around the world. And as an Irish citizen, we often go to Ireland. This is during the Willie Clancy Festival in Milltown Malbay in County Clare, where young traditional musicians learning their craft come together for a weekend, and every pub in town is full of people playing together. Well, and that's something Janice and I just love to do, whether it's in Dublin or Galway or anywhere, Cork. Mm-hmm. There's music everywhere in Ireland.
Dying to go. I'm so jealous of this incredible. I just, maybe before my family finally gets to Ireland, Kevin, maybe I could drop you a line and get a few tips from you about it. Because boy, I'll tell you, we would love to go to this.
I know some of the really good places to go. I think no matter what people do as they're living or what they think of as being their identity, music is a part of all of our lives. I mean, whether it's just through listening to the radio, through active attendance at concerts, through appreciating recorded music, music makes life tolerable. I'm very glad that we have music. I don't know what I would do without it.
Favorite quote from Nietzsche, which you may not want to use, but without music, life would have been a mistake. You know, and America nationally has to fight for this all the time. The arts aren't regarded quite the way they are in Europe and almost every other place in the world, where here the arts, there's a tendency to see them as being dessert or an added extra or something that you can do after you've done your homework or something like that. And I'm extremely fortunate that we're in Santa Monica, which is one of the few places in a place in the country where you don't have to say that. Yeah. Everyone, it's understood in Santa Monica, and in that way, we're a little more European, maybe. But boy, it's fantastic. It makes all the difference in the world for somebody working in the arts. Yes, I hope, Roger, you feel the same way.
I do.
Something that's always astonished me working in government and talking about funding things is that usually when people ask for funding for the arts, they say, well, there's a leverage effect. If you spend this much on the arts, it brings in audiences, it increases the number of people in restaurants, therefore it's a good investment. And I've always found that to be kind of a superfluous argument, because investing in the arts is fundamental. It's one of the things that we should be doing. It helps to bring a community together. It defines a local culture. It's something that has benefits so far beyond the economic that at times I find the economic arguments almost laughable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I couldn't agree more. And you were, one of your questions earlier, Roger, about how do we bring focus to the importance of classical music? I think the fine arts, which is not a term that's used much anymore, but I think it's an important word because with the fine arts, classical music and painting and so forth, and modern dance and everything, we have a focus on creativity. Now, that's very intense and based on a kind of languages that have been passed down and that are learned and that people devote many years to learning and so forth. And that's a necessary kind of peak of the pyramid of creativity, because what comes down from that in effect is all the creativity that we use in every way throughout our lives. I mean, every job in the world requires a degree of creativity. And so there has to be a place where creativity is the only value. And that's where we are in the fine arts.
Well, that's what the future of music is going to look like. This. It's going to not just be an orchestra performing a piece by Beethoven, but it's going to include collaborations with actors, with singers, with visual artists. And that's what we're going to try to do with Orchestra Santa Monica, is make the concert more of a creative event rather than just a concert, if that makes sense. It's not just going to be three musical works. It's going to incorporate youth. It's going to incorporate the arts of all different types. And I think that's the future of music in many ways. I really do. More of an event rather than just a two-hour concert with an intermission.
With excellent sound recording technology and video technology, it became way too easy just to record a performance and then have it be played back later by somebody who wasn't there, which really relegates you to being a consumer, not a creator. And what'll differentiate the live performances coming back after the pandemic is we have the opportunity, as you said, to innovate, participate, and to make the person who's in the audience part of the event. In other words, to awaken that creative instinct in each of us, which lies fallow if all you do is be a consumer of recorded art product.
Yes.
We have to get back into being part of.
That's right.
It's so incredibly true. And nobody, I think, understands the difference between the experience of a live performance being in the room with other people as opposed to a screen or a digital experience than millennials and younger people. They know that sitting at home in front of their screens is not the same thing as going, more than any other group. They're hungry to go out and get together with other people. And they know what that means. And they actually, the flip side is they demand a lot when they go out. They want everything when they get there. They want an event. They don't just want to drop in on a concert, get back in their cars and drive home. They want an evening with a whole bunch of things going on, and they really need it. They need to get off their screens. They know that. So I think in some ways there's an enormous opportunity waiting for us when things really
stop. Oh yeah. And just, you know, humanizing the musicians. They aren't robots just on stage playing in their suits or tuxes. Getting them out into the audience in terms of post-concert receptions and pre-concert activities. We're looking into more of that as well with Orchestra Santa Monica. Letting the audience members meet the musicians and seeing them as people rather than just as musicians who play Beethoven beautifully. So we're trying to do as much of that as we can. And it is a great opportunity to really innovate. Thank you again for taking the time today, and we will talk soon.
Thank you for this, Roger, and happy editing.
It's been an honor. It's been an honor to be with both of you. Thank you so much, Councilmember and Roger.
Keep up the great work. Thank you so much. So long.
Bye-bye.
Bye.